being here. I'm Sebastian, Ruth, founder and artistic director of Community Music Works. So happy to be spending the afternoon with you all. This program grows out of a belief that music originates from and evokes human emotional experiences that we all share across cultures and across time. Tragedy, longing, confusion, discord, resolution, reverence, peace. Today we get to share two extraordinary works written by young female composers who in different ways combine Indian classical music, Hindustani tradition, with Western musical forms. And we get to share one of the sublime late chamber music pieces of Mozart, the G minor viola quintet. And we hope you enjoy this framing. Maybe some of the more familiar sounds will happen in the Mozart. And it might have been traditional to end the program with the familiar sounds. But we felt that to frame the Mozart with these newer voices might be, and hope you find, that it brings us through a real journey from beginning to end. There are some notes in your program about the Tucker and Esmail pieces written by the composers themselves. Jesse will share a little bit about the Mozart before they play that one. And at the end of the evening, we hope you'll join us to share your thoughts with a little reception. We're gonna brave the cold. We have some patio heaters, and we're gonna have snacks outdoors. So at the end of the program, bundle up and come and have a glass of something and a nibble with us. Again, thank you for coming.
Thank you. Wonderful to see everyone, by the way. And we thought it would be kind of fun to do what we used to do a lot, and that set a little bit of a context for this piece. And I was out on a run today, and I was thinking about the piece, and I remembered listening to the classical radio station, and anytime they would bring up Mozart, it was something like, "Relax with Mozart," or "Merlot with Mozart during dinner time." And it really sort of pigeonholed Mozart into this sort of insipid, that is completely relaxing music. And this piece could not be more different from that. I want to read a letter that Mozart wrote to his father from April 4th, this is not the original letter. This is something that, from April 4th, 1787. His father was ailing at the time. "I have now made a habit of being prepared in all the affairs of life for the worst, as death, when we come to consider it closely, is the true goal of our existence. I have formed during the last few years such close relations with this best and truest friend of mankind that his image is not only no longer terrifying to me, but is indeed very soothing and consoling. And I thank God for graciously granting me the opportunity, you know what I mean, of learning that death is the key to happiness. I never go to bed without thinking, this could be my last night." And death was certainly on his mind when he wrote this quintet. Not only his ailing father, who would die of May 28th of that year. Well, just 12 days before he wrote this quintet. And actually Don Giovanni, his darkest opera also dealing with death, would premiere that same year in October. And so you'll hear right from the beginning, and we'd actually like to play just a couple of things to set this up. Right from the beginning, that this is not the Mozart with Merlot for dinner, but there's a dark sadness. But this is not a melodramatic outcry, but more of an internal battle, because it's only the top three voices, and then it's passed down to the bottom voices before finally coming all together. And I realized I didn't open my iPad. So we'd like to play just the opening for you. Or the second character is almost always in major, but he stays in minor, and again with that throbbing underneath. The sun does come out occasionally, but it always returns to the sadness, the resigned sadness. The second movement, okay, usually you'd expect to have a slow movement here, but he presents a minuet. Now, a minuet was a dance, but I would dare any of you to come up and dance to this, as you will not know where to put your feet down. Plus, he stays in G minor with these sort of outcries of pain followed by silence. So we're just going to play the opening of the second movement. To this glowing G major, but there is what's called a da capo, and it comes back and the anger returns. Now, there is a very large seismic shift for the third movement, and completely unexpected, he adds mutes, and he goes into the key of E flat. Now, E flat for Mozart, in fact, we looked this up in a rehearsal, like, what characteristics does E flat have, and according to whatever website this was, it had to do with personal conversations with God. And E flat always took on a religious meaning for Mozart. And the music takes on this glow. And because of the mutes, it's a little bit translucent, as one person put it. We're just going to play the opening. Photographic negative of the first movement. Sadness does come in, a dark sadness comes in throughout this heavenly glow, but it always returns to this ethereal shimmering. Now, also completely inexplicably, he follows this adagio with another adagio. We will play just a tiny bit of this. It's an aria, okay, underneath this pulsing, just like the first movement, okay? Just like the pulsing you just heard. Dun, bum, bum. I'm just gonna play just the opening of this. Thank you. this darkness. And just as inexplicably, out of this comes, well, it's a bit of a surprise, but it's like a big party at the end, out of this sorrow. And it's perplexed many people, what does this mean? Is it the afterlife? Is it the rising from the ashes like a phoenix? Well, the best advice I would say is just to sit back and enjoy. And I just want to say on a personal level, this has been very special for me to play this because I've joined with my former student and now colleague Alexis on this. So this has been extremely gratifying. We will now play the entire content. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.